Douglas, do we have to give up a bit of our liberty in order to increase our protection?
No, I don't think so. And I pretty much agree with everything that's just been said by Peter and a lot of what's just been said by Yasmin. I think that you have to be very careful after these events that you don't leap around, as you say, become hyperactive about it. And I also think that there is a huge problem of rhetoric from politicians about this. We'll see whether President Hollande is indeed merciless towards ISIS. We'll see whether, instead, we don't have a phase like I think we've had in the UK and I think we've arguably had across Europe, where whenever we talk about this subject, our politicians do an extraordinary mix of grandiosity and tinkering.
Well, the word
they
war
say,
has
we
been
are
used
at, we, they say, we are at war with an existential threat, and it is the threat of our time. And then they say, and in response, we must extend surveillance here, or we must do this, or we must do that. Mm. This is not up to the challenge. If you accept that the challenge is there, and I think that it is, if you accept that it is that, then you do not simply tinker.
What do you do?
Well, all sorts of things. One of the things, by the way, it has to be said, one of the things, you would make sure you knew who was coming into your country and you knew who was here. And it is insane that in recent years, at the same time as saying there is an element within Islamic communities, whatever percentage you think it is, which has the potential to be radicalised, which has the potential to have these medieval ideas. If you believe that is true, and now the mainstream politicians across Europe all say that is true, why on earth would you bring an unprecedented number of people from the Muslim world into Europe? Why would you do it?
Osama.
Because the free movement of peoples is also one of our core values in Europe, and we believe in universal human rights, European values of liberty, equality, fraternity are not just European or Western ones. They are Muslim ones as well. The vast majority of the Muslim world, the very young population, they are polled. And they want these kinds of values. But they don't want dictators. And many of them are escaping terrorist groups like ISIS by coming in, right, into Europe. And by showing them that generosity, we are actually undermining the terrorist narrative who are trying to pit them against us. So we actually have to stick to our principles and values and welcome stranger than refugee, because the vast majority will contribute to this society. We have to deal with the terrorist military threat of ISIS. Absolutely, we are at war with them.
Osama, nobody wants you to be right more than I do. Okay, take a poll that came out earlier this year. The BBC conducted it after the Charlie Hebdo massacre, the last massacre in Paris. The BBC poll said that 27% of British Muslims polled said they had sympathy with the attackers in Paris. 27%. It's not a majority. I grant you. It's just a quarter.
We have to deal with the shot.
Hang on, one at a time. Yasmin.
Yeah. No, I mean, of course there are anxieties, and according to some papers, two of the people they think were involved came in through this route of seeking asylum.
Came through Greece from Syria.
Most of the people who are escaping Syria are not ISIS.
Sure.
They're escaping from ISIS. And you shouldn't judge. That's the thing that I'm saying very strongly, that in some ways we Muslims have to stop seeing ourselves primarily as Muslims and see ourselves more as Europeans. There's been a terrible influence of Saudi Arabia that has been allowed to corrupt us. But equally, the Europeans should stop casting us as Muslims first and citizens next. All of that will make a difference. And I am not, like Osama saying, you know, there isn't a problem, there is a big problem. But we need to be, if we're going to be calm, we also need to give some credence to the idea that most of those people who are coming here are desperate.
But it only takes one, Yasmin.
It takes one, but there are criminals coming in.
Okay.
Every day, criminals come in from everywhere.
We're in danger of missing two points. First of all, there's a perfectly sound argument for having controlled borders, even if there were no terrorist attacks at all. And I don't think that using a terrorist attack as a pretext for this argument is particularly a good idea. A terrorist attack is bad in its own right, and we respond to it in its own right. If you mean by open borders that you have a wholly undiscriminating system where people can just walk into a country without anybody knowing who they are or where they come from, then I think any reasonable person must be against that. The really curious thing about the European Union is that its current policy is exactly that. People can come in unchecked, undocumented, and they can then move unchecked throughout the entire European Union because of the Schengen Agreement. That would seem to me to be crazy under any circumstances, even if there were no terrorist attacks. And I'd be amazed that anyone would defend that if that's what you mean by open borders. But there is a much more serious point about this, is that what actually is IS? What is the nature of its threat to us? And how, if it is such a threat to us, are we going to combat it? Now, I think a lot of the solutions to this lie not in domestic but in foreign policy. We've been most reluctant, for instance, to ally properly with the Kurds, who've been the most effective fighters against ISIS on the ground. We've been most unwilling to ally with Iran, and we've been extremely critical of Russia, which has also been rather more effective in holding up the Syrian regime, which is one of ISIS's principal opponents, okay, than we have. We might reconsider some of these things if we're serious about opposing and defeating ISIS as a major force.
OK. I want to bring in Dr. Chris Allen from our newsroom in Birmingham. Thank you very much for joining us, Dr. Allen. Is there an answer to this? Does it lie in a change in foreign policy? Does it lie in perhaps getting rid of the Schengen agreement, the open borders agreement, and having a more rigorous approach towards people who are coming into Europe? What's your answer?
Well, from listening to the discussion so far, I think what's really interesting for me is the way in which we've started with one thing and kind of got to something completely different. And, you know, if you look at the language that's been used, we're talking about Muslims as a blanket community around the world. So we've been talking about Muslims in Syria and Iraq in the same way we're talking about Muslims in Britain. We're talking about immigration, which is not necessarily a Muslim issue. You know, this is an issue which is quite different and distinct. But now suddenly we're talking about immigration as though it's actually problematic because of Muslims coming to this country. And I think one of the things that we really need to do here is to kind of, like, you know, begin to differentiate between a lot of these different debates and discussions that are taking place. And if we're talking about this issue around sort of what's happened in Paris and what should we do, I think the message is actually one of calm. You know, if we look in after 7/7 and Lee Rigby and all these things, these were actually on British soil. You know, these are things which impact, you know, Britain directly. And, you know, what we have now is something which has taken place in Paris, which is, you know, which is horrific. But is it actually going to affect us in Britain at the moment? You know, and we're talking as though now there's going to be an attack here imminently, you know, and I think that this is just very, very worrying. I think that what we need to do is we need to have a little bit of nuance. We need to have a little bit of calm. And I think actually one of the ways forward is to actually look at this as an intelligence issue, you know, and actually talk about sort of, you know, these other issues in a much more kind of balanced and nuanced way.
Douglas, is it an intelligence issue? I mean, obviously not solely an intelligence issue, but did intelligence let everybody down in Paris?
Well, first, I don't think anyone or anything's been said so far in this studio lacks nuance. I think rather patronising dismissal of the idea that it does is in another attempt, which always happens after events like this, to change the point or to limit the discussion. Actually, this is, as I say, a very, very large issue. It's a societal issue. It's a cultural issue. What happened in Paris the other night, it wasn't the first time it's happened. It goes on and on and on. It is not possible to have that discussion and police and to make sure that all sorts of elements of it we don't have. We have to have the full discussion.
So would you have the full discussion, for example, about... Before you... Just to pick up on that point, would you have a full discussion about airstrikes... Not just airstrikes in Syria, because, of course, that was voted down a couple of years ago in the House of Commons.
Well, no.
It hasn't come back yet. But other things. Is it boots on the ground? Is it absolutely trying to get rid of ISIS once and for all in Syria?
I said a long time ago, it's a perfectly legitimate objective. Once ISIS carried out an attack on another country, for that country to use every bit of military force it has to destroy that group. What was proposed 2 years ago was not that. What was proposed 2 years ago were punitive strikes against the Assad regime. You may agree with that or not. I actually disagreed with punitive strikes against the Assad regime because I thought it would topple the Assad regime and meant that we would own Syria when we didn't want to own Syria. But strikes against ISIS obviously are legitimate. As for quickly the surveillance issue. You can have all of the surveillance in the world and things like this can still happen. You will never be secure enough that a barbarian will not get hold of a Kalashnikov somewhere and go and massacre people for the crime of going to a restaurant. You will never have enough surveillance. And we should not blame security services either here or in Paris for not being able to prevent that happening at any time, all the time.
Can I just hear from Osama, because I haven't heard from him for a while. Is it about then taking a different approach, as far as we're concerned, in foreign policy towards Syria, going in there and going in there a lot harder than anyone has done?
I think we should call a spade a spade. In Syria, you have a brutal regime of Assad, which has killed over 200,000 people. And we have a brutal group like ISIS, murdering thousands of people also, mainly Muslims. We need a political solution to Syria to end the war.
But what is that political solution?
Well, there are talks going on in Vienna. There are so many powers. The reason we haven't allied with the Kurds as much is because Turkey is an ally and opposed to the Turkish group, for example. And of course, there are obvious problems with Iran and Russia supporting Assad. But coming back to an earlier point, we do need that debate to continue. You mentioned Charlie Hebdo correctly. A lot of Muslims falsely thought that these were blasphemous cartoons depicting the Prophet. Within a year, I think opinion has moved on amongst British and European Muslim communities because, for example, Charlie Hebdo also published a cartoon about Aylan Kurdi, the boy who was drowned, a cartoon about the Russian plane that was brought down by a bomb, which many Russians were offended by. And so people are beginning to understand that, you know, many people get offended by the unique satirical nature of Charlie Hebdo. We have to continue that discussion so that people don't sympathise with these kinds of murderers anymore. Oh. And we're moving in the right direction in Britain and Europe. We have to continue
to have open, honest conversations.
Yes, citizenship.
But also, I really do want to give some credit to the security services here. I know for a fact, and the police too, that some terrible disasters have been prevented. They don't talk about them. They can't talk about them sometimes. The downside of that is too often blameless Muslims are held without charge and so on, and that needs to change. I think we have to maintain those rights. But there has been some good work done by people to keep us safe, so we shouldn't dismiss what they've been able to do.
Don't overrate these organisations. James Bond is fiction and so is Spooks. There's surprisingly little they can do, and the fundamental thing they are not and never will be is clairvoyant. They simply can't tell what's going to happen before it happens. And the idea that by intense surveillance and more poking into our lives they will do so is
what
false.
What is the answer then, Peter?
Well, why are we always looking for the answer? If there had been a plane crash, we would get hold of the flight recorders and we would look to see what had happened in detail, and we would in detail work to ensure it didn't happen again. The same should be done here. What is actually going on? What should we actually be preventing? What should we actually be fighting? What should our foreign policy be? Particularly what our foreign policy would be. Beginning from September the 11th, 2001, we've had a stupid foreign policy towards this part of the world which has caused far more trouble than it's solved. To continue to believe that tanks, bombs, airstrikes and boots on the ground will solve this problem when it's failed over all this length of time seems to me to be incredibly stupid.
Thank you for that. You've been sending us a lot of texts and tweets this morning. Tommy?
Yes, thank you, Sian. Yes, clearly a very emotive subject, and thank you for all the messages. Here are just some of them. Ian on Facebook says, Britain should stay out of other countries' business. It's simple. Always wanted to poke our noses in. It's causing more hate and more problems. Elaine makes a point that Peter Hitchin made today. It says, there should be no panic and no knee-jerk reactions. And she goes on to say that we should not allow them to divide and conquer either by blaming Muslims for this. Sue says, would it not be sensible to stop those who travel to Syria from re-entering the UK? Let them know that if they go, they will not be able to return. Bruce says, if we challenged anti-Muslim sentiment, would we deprive Islamic extremists of a vital nutrient without which it cannot flourish? And we've just had this video sent in from Paul.
In order to get this right at its root, one has to reform Islam. In much the same way that Christianity is being reformed, Islam needs a reformation. And without that, it's going to carry on recruiting lots of these suicide bombers, because in the end of the day, they are following what they believe is written down.
Islam needs reform, Sean. That's what Paul
says. Thank you very much. I want to pick that up with Chris, who joins us from our Birmingham studio. What do you make of that last comment about Islam needing reforming, and that's the way forward?
Well, I always find it interesting that non-experts can actually tell other religions what they need to do. It's like I'm not a theologian for Judaism, so I wouldn't tell the Jewish faith what it needs to do. I think that a lot of people kind of take these things on and they hear these debates about reformation of Islam. I mean, what would that actually do? Religions change and they do evolve and they develop over many years, not just over centuries. These are constantly changing. What we have here is, and picking up on some of the points from previously, is that actually, if we get rid of Islamic State, if we bomb Islamic State, well, we create a void which is going to be filled by other extremists. If we look back to our own government in December 2013 in the Extremism Task Force, at that time, the British government was talking about the greatest threat coming from Al-Qaeda. So once Al-Qaeda, moves on, we get a new ideology which fills it.
What would you do, Chris? Sorry to interrupt, but we also heard that there are more than 700 British people who've gone out to Syria and 400 or so have come back. Does that not give you cause for concern?
Well, I think it is concerning, but I think one of the things we've got legislation in place where actually my understanding is that when people come back from Iraq or Syria, that they can be arrested. So there's questions around why is the legislation not being used and why is the policy not there. I think one of the things that we've actually done which is wrong is this idea that we can actually kind of de-radicalise people here in this country. You know, right. If you look over, you know, right back to New Labour in the post-77 period, you know, we've had this huge investment from the British government in this kind of prevent agenda of trying to, you know, take people off and make them, you know, sort of much more moderate Muslims, if that's even a term. I mean, what do we mean by this? And I think that actually this hasn't worked. You know, this has just been sort of, you know, bringing Muslim organisations to the table that agree with government, rubber stamping, you know, governmental ideas.
Thank you.
Chris Allen is pushing a particular point of view here, but it's not one I agree with. Reformation of Islam, whatever that means, would mean that when an attack like this happened, there was no legitimacy whatsoever for it happening. And the problem is, and let me give you a very quick example. Take late last year, that young Jordanian pilot whose plane came down and he was burned alive in Syria by these ISIS barbarians. When that happened, Al-Azhar, the most important school of Sunni jurisprudence in Islam, issued a criticism of this happening. But they said, by the way, they said that the people who did it should be crucified for doing this. But they said that ISIS are indeed extremist, but the problem is that they are not heretics. They are not heretics. Now, Uzama knows, and Yasmin knows, and everyone else here knows, this is the central problem. Chris Allen is right on one thing.
They are heretics.
This is not... Hang on. So can I just finish
the point? I think that was a mistranslation. Okay. What they said, they're not non-Muslim, you can't excommunicate them. Theologically, that's a problem.
Let Uzama respond to your point, because is it about that sort of... that clarity of message about what Islam is?
The message should be clearer, but the theologians of Islam today are unanimous. Every single one is condemning ISIS because they are killing so many Muslims everywhere.
And
Islam is going through a reformation, has been for the last century and a half.
Yeah,
it takes centuries, as the Christian one did.
The elephant in the room is Saudi Arabia. Yeah. The man we treated like the king of the universe a few weeks ago. If you want to know how the theology has been kidnapped, restricted, homogenized, forcibly changed from the diversity that Islam enjoyed, you have to look to Saudi Arabia and some of the Gulf states. We don't want to do that.
No, it's it is an enormously important point, and Yasmin is quite right to raise it. And Saudi Arabia is, apart from anything else, hugely important in the formation of British and, I might say, French foreign policy, because it is such an important client, a buyer of arms, and
reform
general...
in Saudi Arabia will help Muslims worldwide.
All right,
certainly.
It certainly needs.
The point is that this civil war is now here, and that is the problem.
Thank you to all of you, and thank you for all your comments.